for the floating point arithmetic, we just discuss only addition and multiplication. The floating point number is actually the representation of real number. That means the number with the decimal point, right? Such as pi, okay, or constant e, or some other engineering notation, right? Very small number like this. This is to all right. Nanosecond, okay. If you think of this, this is the 1 second. Then 0.01 is a 1 nanosecond. Okay. Our processor actually working very fast. The clock is, say, if it's just 1 gigahertz, it's already 1 nanosecond. Okay, so it's very fast. And it's some very large number. Okay, so it's 2,000 million. Okay. So as you are in engineering, we use this kind of having the power of 10 at the end, and we call this kind of presentation a scientific notation. Okay, so we can deal with a very large and very small number. Okay, so the last two is a scientific notation, and another term is a normalized. Normalized mean, of course, we have this very different, let's say the last two, the very different way to show the number. So we want to show it such a way that there is no leading zero. That for this one, you think we shift everything, right, to the left, okay? And then change the exponential number at the end, right? So it's 0.01 become 1.0 and change this exponent. Okay. Similarly, we move everything to be 1 decimal. No leading zero. Okay, that's all. And change the exponent in the scientific notation. And we call these the last two presentation here as a normalized number. Right, so let's continue. Now, the processor used in the textbook have two formats to store the floating point number. One is a 32-bit, okay, which is more or less standard, right? That is a two standard, and the other is 64-bit. The 32-bit we call single precision, and 64-bit we call double precision. Because we have a normalized number, so we can store a fraction and exponent, all right? For the fraction, we have the leftmost bit as a sign bit. So for the fraction is a sign binary. Okay, so it contains 23 bits, and then 1 bit as a sign. It is not two complement, okay? It's a sign and a number, okay? And the exponent, so the in general, the number can be represented in this form. The first one is a sign, either it's minus or plus, and a fraction, and then the exponent. Right, so you because there are only a finite number of bits that we can use to present the floating point number, so not all the number can be present, right? We can have a very dense, very small number close together, but when the number go large, it is the density is less and less and less, okay? Unlike the integer, that the density is uniform. The next number is as close, just one different, right? And it's always like this. But it's not true for the floating point number stored in the computer, because there are finite bits that we can store. And the real number have the infinite number, so that we cannot store all of them. We lost some precision. Right? So with this single precision on RISC-V processor, we can have a very small number, 2 to the, and then by 10 to the power of 38 and minus, the exponent can be minus or plus. If you have the number that is cannot store in this form, that we call it overflow, and it also there's some very small number that cannot be stored in this form, and we call it underflow, and the hardware and the software have to detect this condition, because when you multiply two number or adding two number, just like integer, it can get overflow. And when if you different to number, it may be some too small to store in this format. To make it more precision digit, we can use a double precision, okay? If we use 62 bit to store the number. And then you can see the fraction become 32 by 20, even 52 bits, right? Single precision has only 23 bits, right? The exponent, let me see, this exponent is 11 bits, and the single precision exponent is at 8 bits. Okay. So the range of number is now 10 to the power of 308, right? Plus and minus. So huge range of number that you can use in your calculation in the processor. Before we go to the operation, we have to understand the standard, because different machine, if they use a different way to store the floating point number, unlike integer, most of them are quite similar, because integer are integer, right? All of them use, well, very rare, very ancient machine that use different way. All of today machine use two complement integer. So if any machine is similar, different only just how many bits they have, 32 bit, or right now it's a, if you use a very small processor, it's a 8 bit, 16 bit, 32 bit, and 64, right? Today, as we program and use our machine, is 32 and 64, almost across any machine that you will meet. Okay. However, without the some kind of standard, different machine will use a different way to present the floating point number, and also this standard currently already evolved. Okay, to improve. Even better. It's slightly different than the one we show you. Okay. And well, and we implement quite economically in the processor in RISC-V. And I think the standard is a bit more involved. You have to put in more extra resource to be able to do that. So, as you know, there's no leading zero. So actually, the leading digit in binary is one. For IEEE standard, take advantage of it and say, hey, we don't have to store this one, because all the floating point number have to begin with digit one, okay? In the fraction part, right? So previously, we have 23 bits. And IEEE ignore the first one because it's implicit. You don't have to write it down, it's already there. So it can increase one precision in another bit. So it actually 24 bit versus width 5, 23. And because of this, we call this part of fraction to make, to in the textbook, Right? Or in some ultimate standard, we call it significant. Okay, rather than fraction. Okay, so you can see that fraction is add by one. Okay, so the exponent is stored as what they call bias number. So zero become, let's say we use bias 120. So number 127 is actually the exponent zero. You can see from here that is the exponent minus bias, right? With that, the range of a single precision is to minus 126 and plus 127. Okay, the standard also contains some convenient way to represent object, such as number zero. Okay, object zero is special, infinity number. Okay, and the last strange object is not a number, because once you do some calculation and it become invalid in terms of presenting it out. So you say divide by zero or something, right? So when you execute that, and the result become like that, okay? If you show the object not a number or NaN, right? The first example is show you minus 0.75. Okay, so but we talk about the base 10, and we want to convert it into the binary, and which you can see the result below. Okay, right, 32 bit. Okay, so how it is done? Let's say the 0.75 is a 3/4, okay? And we change. Actually, we try to normalize the number. Okay, at first we change the fraction into a proper binary number. So we change a 3 by 4, and then 4 become 2 to the power of 2. Change the 3 to binary 1 1, okay, and 2, okay. And when we have these what they call exponent, then we can write properly like this. 0.11, okay, in the base 2, right? So now it's in base 2, okay. The first digit is multiplied by 2 to the power of minus 1. The second digit 2 to the power of minus 2, all right? If we write in scientific notation, this 0.11 become like this with the exponent 0, like this. Then remember that we have to normalize the number, okay? So we cannot have leading 0, all right? So we shift thing a little bit, and then the exponent become minus 1. And then we break this into two parts of the fraction and exponent. The exponent has to be biased by 127, and the fraction has to, yeah, have to, what do you call, eliminate the first digit, okay? So it become, right? This is implicit. The 1 plus is not stored in the bit pattern. It's just we know that there is bit 1, okay? So when we write in terms of mathematics, we have this number 1 here, in which if we change everything into binary, it becomes like this. It's presented by this number, the exponent. Say, given this pattern of single precision IEEE standard number in the memory, what is this in decimal number? Okay, so similarly, we have this 0 1 and a large number of zero at the fraction. Okay, And the sign bit is 1, so this is definitely a negative number. Okay. Exponent is 129, and bias by 127, so come down to 2, right? To the power of 2. And let's say this one, the first one is 1.5, okay? Say 0, so not count. The second one is 1 and the fourth, right? The second one digit, right? So 2 to the power of minus 2, okay? So 1/4, so it's 0.25 in decimal, okay? So this part, and also this is I20, so we have implicit 1, the first digit. So it convert down like this. So calculate everything, it become minus 5. First is addition, right? This is a flowchart to do it. The idea is, if you have two numbers, before you can add them, you have to align the decimal point together, right? So we in order to do that, we have to, in terms of floating point representation, we have to change the exponent so the two numbers that want to be added have the same exponent, okay? So we usually get the smaller number to become larger number. Okay? So we change the smaller exponent to be equal to another number before we add them. By changing the exponent, because we renormalize or realign the decimal point. Once the exponent has been aligned, then we can add. After we add the fraction part, then maybe the result have the leading zero. So we have to renormalize again. So the result become the proper normalized number. It's easier to look at the example. We want to add 0.5, 0.4375 or minus, right? So let's change that into a floating point number. In this example, we use 4 bit, okay? The first number, 0.5, we can change it to this number. And the other number is a bit more complicated. It's you change the fraction part and the exponent part, okay? Exponent part change to what we call scientific notation, okay? And then we change the fraction part into binary, okay? And with the scientific notation, okay? And then we normalize it, right? So these two number is stored in the floating point number already. So let's try to add them. First of all, we have to adjust the exponent of the smaller number to be as the large number. Okay, so the smaller number is this number. So we do to adjust it to the power of minus 1, right? So 1.1 exponent minus 2, then 0.1 exponent minus 1. Now the decimal point is aligned between two numbers, so we can add the fractional part together. So the first number is 1000, the second number is 0111. Okay, so it is also the negative number. Okay. Remember the fractional part is sign magnitude, so it's not two complement, all right? So we add these two numbers and it becomes 0001, okay, and the positive, right? And the exponent is still the same, right? Minus 1 exponent in base 2. Next step is, of course, the this number is not normalized, so we have to adjust the exponent. This one is, we shift the decimal point to the right, so we increase, right, to 1.0, right, minus 4. The result is, first we have to check overflow and underflow. And the result is between 27 and minus 126, so it's okay. There's no underflow and overflow occur. These numbers have no extra bit, have to be round, so it stays the same. And then this is a result. Okay, if you want to know is in decimal, in the base 10, you can convert it back and it become 0.0625 in base 10. Arithmetic operation on floating point number is take more processor cycle than the integer addition, right? All the processor that can do IEEE standard floating point contain this kind of floating point unit with this number and this number, right? And going to do this one, a kind of adjusting the exponent, okay, right? Because you can see that it get the exponent part, okay? You use that to align the fraction part together, right? Here by shifting unit, okay? Shifting unit, you can shift the binary digit to the right or to the left. This one is shifting to the right, okay? And then there's nothing. It is just an ALU to add. And now this part is routing hardware plus normalization. And the result of the chip until there's no leading zero. Okay, multiplication in a way is easier than adding, right? Let's imagine that. If we have two floating point numbers, first of all, consider exponent. When you multiply two numbers, you just add exponent together, right? And what about a fraction? Fraction is just multiply, okay. Renormalize, that's it. Okay, let's see the example. We want to multiply the same number, 0.5 and 0.4375. Negative in this end is not difficult because we use a magnitude and sign. Okay. So we can calculate without having to present the two complement numbers. All right, so again, we have these two numbers in floating point, which is already shown by previous example. So we have these two numbers, okay? And then let's consider exponent minus one for the first number and minus two for the second number. So it become minus three, okay? We have to adjust this to bias presentation. So it become 124, right? Because it add by 127 minus 3, 124. In binary digit, they already align, right? Because it's already normalized in this binary before we do operating. So we just use the integer multiplication. In this example, we use four digit of binary for the digit precision. So the result of multiplication become 4, 5, 6, 7 digit. So we have to round it, okay? So we have to cut out the rightmost because it's least significant. We have to drop three digits on the right. So it become, in this case, it's not losing anything, right? So it become 1.110. We check if the result is overflow, underflow by checking the exponent, it's okay. Okay, then the result is this one. Now we have to put back the sign. Two numbers have different sign. Therefore, the result have to be negative. All right. If it's the same sign, then it becomes positive. Okay, so this number convert back to become minus 0.21875. Show you the actual instruction that support those operation. Okay, so we have something like floating point addition. You do not have to do the small step by yourself. It is done by floating point hardware. Okay. Yeah. So you probably can recognize that because the floating point have single precision and double precision. So we have two set of instruction, one for single precision, one for double precision. So we have add floating single precision, add double precision, subtraction, multiplication, division, square root. To do the square root fast, we have a special circuit for that as well, right? And then comparing two numbers, which is actually when you want to do equality, it become in term of engineering, it become troublesome because if you have if you imagine two real number, not floating point, it may not be to have it exactly the same is quite difficult. So we usually test equality by subtracting two number and allow it to be the same if it less than epsilon. So we can set epsilon. Epsilon can be one in million, okay, one in thousand, one in ten, depend on the precision you want. So you in terms of programming, we never really test A equal B when both are real numbers. No, we usually A minus B less than epsilon, okay? When you multiply two number together, it become twice as large. So you to get it back to the standard number, you have to round it. How to round without losing the precision? To do that, we have so-called guard bit. It is inside the circuit to do floating point. It is not visible to the programmer. Okay. The guard bit actually two extra digits to the right, because we want to keep the precision. Therefore, you can have these two extra digits, and then you can round off by consider if this digit is nearer to one or nearer to zero. Let's say if two digits is 100, right? If you have a 50, then you have to decide larger than 50, you can round to nearer to one, right? Less than 50, this is the least significant two digits, okay? So if it's less than, then you can round to zero. This example show you when you add two numbers together, okay, and you can round. If you have the guard bit, you have the extra two digit on the right, then it round to one number, okay? And if you don't have the extra digit, then it round to another number. Okay, let's see how it differs. So we have these two number, 2.56 and 2.34, okay? With the different exponent. So we just align them. Okay, and let's say we have those extra two digit of a guard digit, right? And in decimal number, it's become like this. So they you add them together, and it become like this. Okay. So now we have to decide how to round this number. Okay. Let's because we have this just three digit, okay. So we have the last two digits is 56. So you probably want to round it into one, right? So if it become one, then it become 2.37, right? But if we don't have this, got a bit the last two digits, then we can do something like this. Okay, it's straightforward because no guard bit. So when we round it, it become 2.36. Now you know these two number are different. The first number is closer to the truth. Now that we go through all the detail about the instruction of a processor, including arithmetic. Have you ever wondered, in terms of a normal program, which instruction is mostly used, right? So in this table or figure, it shows running RISC-V processor running this CPU 2006 benchmark, CPU spec 2006, and you can know more about what kind of program it run. Okay, so this is the statistic collect from those benchmark.